Women's Call 300. And I welcome you to our class. This is going to be an exciting 13 weeks together, and I look forward to working with each and every one of you. So, to begin, we're going to go ahead and look at some of the criteria that is needed to be in this class, and certainly some of the other classes that you can take. I find this very, very forward thinking that a university as wonderful as Cal State University is to put together a classroom like this. I'll begin to tell you a little bit more about that in just a second. Let me get this out of the way so that you know of other classes that you can jump right into. And so here we go. This class is part of the Applied Studies Bachelor's Degree Completion Program. That's always a mouthful for me. Classes are broadcast live on cable television channel and webcast on the internet each week. So in case you miss one of our classes here, which I'm sure that you don't ever want to do, but if you do, you can certainly come back and look out at the internet and go through the whole process again. This, can you believe it's 2010? Happy New Year to all of you. This spring we'll be broadcasting 4 classes. Management 312, which is organizational behavior. We have that on Tuesdays from 7 o'clock to 9 p.m. That is a great class, and I'm sure you wouldn't want to miss this. This really kind of adds from our class to communication, moving into the behavior side of class. So, by all means, check this class out. This is a good one. Sociology 315, that is called Sociology of Work. It's on Saturdays from noon to 1:40 p.m. And again, that's another great class. If you're in business or any type of area you have to do with people, this is another good class because we have to understand the social side of people as well. Marketing 350. Now, who can live without marketing? Marketing is very important in today's time. So, whether it be your company, whether it be a product, whether it be you, social marketing is huge today. I teach this in other areas, and I know that this class is very good here, too. It's Principles of Marketing, and it's on Saturdays from 1:50 to 3:30 p.m. And then, of course, our class, and that's called 300 Organizational Communications, and this is on Sunday from noon to 2 p.m. So, now, here comes the good stuff. If you've completed the first 2 years of college, you can earn your bachelor's degree. Think about that. You can earn your full bachelor's degree by enrolling in these classes. All of these classes, you need to complete your bachelor's degree program, and they'll be broadcasted on this channel during the next 2 years, and then guess what? We're going to start all over again, so if you go out and go on vacation and you miss this, you can come back a year from now and still take it. That's how great these classes are, so don't miss out. Now, if you'd like more information about this Applied Bachelor's Degree Completion Program, you can visit us on our website, and our website is www.appliedstudies.tv. Remember that, .tv, this is on your own TV right here, or you can call at 1-866-278-6789, all right? So again, it's on your screen, don't be afraid to write that down because I'm going to want you to call in and join some of these other classes. This would just be a great way. You know, I often think about this, I think, geez, how lucky you are to be able to do your studies this way. You know, I always had to laugh at my parents when they used to say, oh, you used to walk uphill both ways, and here I'm going to do that same thing with you at this point. When I did my degrees, I was lucky enough to have this type of a program. Of course, I got in my car every morning, and I would drive down to the university, which was actually 2 hours away from where I lived. And I would take the classes, and then I'd jump back into my car, and I'd drive back home. But what was really interesting about this whole process was that we used to sit in a library. In a library. Yep, a brick-and-mortar library. And so you're very fortunate to have this, and I look forward and have the pleasure of being more productive for the next few weeks. So, where do we begin? Well, give you a background of who I am, and then we can go from there. My background is I was a CEO for 12 years of quite a large manufacturing company. It had 4,000 people. Sometimes we had 3,000, but most of the time we had 4,000 people. And it was in New York City, and I just loved being a manufacturer's CEO. It was great. It taught me a lot. And so what I bring to you today from a background is from a background of a CEO, but also I've run many other little companies, and so I can bring to you other ways of other disciplines, other not only disciplines, but areas that I've been in, where I sat, my director, vice president, and stuff like that. So I'm not only going to bring you the theory, but I'm going to bring you the applied practice as well. I always find that in today's time, if you can put what you're learning to the application, how lucky are you? So for instance, when I talk to many, many different companies today, I often ask them what they're looking for. What they're looking for is people who have gone to school and are able to take the information and apply it. So in this class especially, that's what we're going to do, is we're going to take the information, then we're going to apply it. We're not going to apply it here in this classroom. And why do I say in this classroom? Because guess what? I want you to call. I want you to call in at different times. And here's how you're going to know how to call. Whenever I put up what I call the talking ball, this is my talking ball. So when you see this, that means that I truly want you to call that number, the 800-339-1193, and call and ask some questions. Because I can only give you what I know, but you probably have some questions out there that you would like answered. So from now till the end, which is April 11th, if I'm not mistaken, I'm going to have not only me in here, but I'm going to bring you some of the best experts that you could ever get a hold of. In fact, some of these experts you couldn't even touch. You wouldn't be able to get a hold of some of these people. And yet they're going to be here, and you're going to have the opportunity to call in and talk to them. So how lucky are you? How wonderful is this? All right, so back to what I was saying here. My background is from business, but then what I did was I decided that I really needed a good education. So my education, as many of you can see from the syllabus, is, but we not only have people in our audience here from the class, we not only have 70 people there, but we also have the general public out there. So just to give you a quick flair and flavor of who I am, my background is three masters and a doctorate. So most of them are in business, but one of them is in culture and communication. Now, why do I tell you that? The reason I tell you that is because one of the things that I have found is that my culture and communication background has been one of the most important degrees that I took today. Yes, all of those are master's degrees, and one's a doctorate. But I will tell you that the communication degree really is the thread that weaves between all of the other master's degree and the doctorate degree. It's what binds it together. Yes, that's right. It's what binds it together. And so because of that, I tell you that this class right here today, this organizational behavior class that you're about to embark on, is going to be one of your most important classes that you could ever take in your college career. I bank on that. I am telling you this, that out of all of my education, out of all of my business knowledge, communication is the most important piece. Now, how do I back that up? You go, come on, Dr. Green, how do you back that up? I'm going to show you how you back that up. I have the top 10 reasons why communication is important. Reason number 10, we're going to start from the bottom all the way up to the top. Here you go. Reason number 10, over 5,000 executives, yes, not 4,099. This isn't, midnight TV, I'm going to give it to you for $29.99. No, no, I said, the highest overall significant role in management and advancement. That's right. About 4 in 5 respondents cited communication as the single number one most important course for career preparation. That's right. Number one skill. Remember what I just got done saying? You know, five high degrees. And what do I look at? I'm looking at my communication degree because it's very important. And that's why this course is so important. I want you here every single week. I want you to be calling in. I want you to be emailing in. I want you to participate. That's how we make this class fabulous. That's how you and I touch one another. That's how you and I interact with one another. We're going to have a fabulous class. And so because of you, you're going to be able to help us, okay? It's not just going to be, you know, Dr. Green over here, da-da-da-da-da. Nope, it's going to be you and me together. We're going to make this happen. Now, here's the other thing. I don't talk out of the side of my mouth without some research. So you're going to find that on here, I am going to post this on our site in our classroom. But as I said before, there are people out there that are not part of our classroom. If you want a copy of this, you want to find out where I got this information from, you just email me. You email me at drvgreen@roadrunner.com and you say, Dr. Green, give me the 10 top reasons and I'll send you this information. It's got research behind it. It's not just me sitting up here spouting. It has research behind it. All right, number 9, reason. Harvard Business Review. You all know who the Harvard Business Review is. Those readers place the ability to communicate as the top, ranked criteria for management success. That's right, the top. All right, number 8 reason. Let's look at the number 8 reason. Over 1,000 executives selected communication as very important more often than, listen, here we go, listen to this, more than any other course in business school curriculum. Do you hear me? I'm telling you, more than any other business school curriculum. See, I was a liar to you. I'm telling you that's what it is. Number 7, here we go. CEOs from over 5,000 U.S. companies from a wide range of industries. This isn't just from the regular, you know, industry. This is from a wide range of industries. We're asked, what are the 3 most important things you have learned in order to perform your role as an executive? Guess what they write first. What? Am I hearing you? Can I hear you? Say it. Yell at me. Yell at the TV. Communication. That's right. Communication is the number 1. Number 1. Here we go. Reason number 6. Can you tell I get excited about this class? I am so excited. Well, I'm excited about most of my classes, but this is a great class. Rule number 6. 95% of the respondents indicated that the ability to communicate orally and in writing were factors considered important for success in the job. Now, interestingly enough, I'll look at this. This was back in 1980. What do you think? 1980, this happened, but from Harvard. What do you think about today? What about today? 2010. You know how many people are unemployed? Here in California, it's over the top. So now's a great time to, A, number 1, take this class. Number 2, you still have time to enroll. But number 2 is it's also important for you to be able to write and also speak. Now's a good time. You don't need just to go to school for this. This is a great time to practice. Practice this, okay? This is a number 6 reason for you. Let's look at the number 5 reason. Number 5 reason is a survey of 175 personnel managers, okay? Your HR people who get to know who you are, the people who hire you, found that both oral and written communication skills are the most important and valuable skills a graduating business students can have and acquire. What am I saying to you? I am telling you, communications. Number 4, ineffective communications is very expensive. We're going to talk about that in just a few minutes, how expensive it really could be. But the National Commission on Writing estimates that American businesses spend, are you ready for this? Sit down, because this is going to knock you down when you hear how big this number is. Are you ready for this? No, it's not thousands. No, it's not millions. No, ladies and gentlemen, number three, the changing environment, increasing complexity of the 21st century workplace make communication even more important. That's right. In a recent survey of 4,000 to 5,000 companies, 83% reported that their firms use Teams. That's right. And Teams are all about communication, right? How do you run a team without communication? Somebody write to me. Tell me how you run a team without communication. It's going to have oral, it's going to have written, it's going to have nonverbal, it's going to have all parts of the communication. And guess what? That's what we're going to learn. That's how exciting this class is. Yes. All right. Reason number two. Here we go. Reason number two is that this survey of Fortune 500 vice presidents shows that 97.7%, that's almost 98%, right, of them believe that, this is quote, this isn't from Dr. Green, this is a quote, quote, believe that communication skills have an effect on their advancement to a top executive position. You know, it's pretty interesting, because here's something I want to tell you something. I don't teach a CAD class where someone doesn't say to me, Dr. Green, how did you get to be a CEO, or how do I get to be a CEO? Well, here's the answer, and here's the truth of the answer. Learn how to communicate. Learn about your organization and learn how to communicate. If you learn those two things, you have 98% of your issues already there. And then the last 2% is know your material. Know your material, know your product. That's how you get to be a CEO. And let's look at the number one reason. The number one reason here is because it's all about communication. Every part of the world is about communication. That's it. It's about written, about verbal, it's about nonverbal, it's about email. And guess what? We're going to look at all that today. That's what we're going to look at. So, there are your top 10 reasons. How about I am? That was pretty darn good, right? Top 10 reasons. I want to start it out with a bang, and that's what we did. So, where do I go from here? Well, let's start right here. What I want to do, I want to talk a little bit about your syllabus, just a little bit. If some of you have gotten out to the website today, out on Blackboard, I have added a few questions out there that I expect, and I put times and dates on them, so you'll be able to go out and look at those, and remember that I expect you to interact with each other and respond to one another throughout the week. So this isn't just, well, answer the question, and then drop off the side of communication here. No, this is a communication class. I want you on as much as possible and responding to each other, and I'll be out there responding too. Each week, I'm not going to sit here and go through page after page of what we're doing in the classroom, because as I said before, we actually have other people in our classroom too, which is kind of nice. And I'm hoping those people, those of you that are out there in TV land that would like to participate, by all means, please do so. Don't hesitate to call in. We really enjoy your calls. In just a few minutes, we're going to open up the lines, and again, there it is, 800-339-1193. So, but I do want to go over just spend a few minutes here on the syllabus. You'll be able to write to me online, and I definitely will respond back to you. But again, the only thing I'm concerned about at this point is that you're paying attention, you have a good glass of water, you're comfortable, you have the telephone near you, you got your computer near you where you can go ahead and talk to me, email me if you don't want to talk on the phone, but by all means, either way, this communication, let's communicate. Two things. One, two books. Here's the first book. Now, my book is written over because I love this book. Maybe we could get a shot of this, please. This is your first book. This is the strategy book. This is from O'Hare, and Frederick and Dixon's Strategic Communications in Business and the Professions. This is 6th edition. You should be able to, I'll move this up a little bit, you should be able to find this out there. We've gone ahead and ordered it. And the second book is the Stephen May book. I don't have that with me today, but it's Case Studies in Organizational Communications. We're going to look at ethical perspectives and practices. Again, as I said to you before, it's very important that we apply the knowledge that we're learning here. And that's why I'm telling you it's good for you to call in just a few minutes. So the rest of the syllabus is pretty self-explanatory. If not, by all means, write to me. I'll gladly write back to you. All right. So Before I start, I want to look at communications failures. If you have the overhead again, please, could you put this? This to me is what a communication failure is, in a sense. We'll just put that there. How about that? Let's look at what happens when we have some communication failures here. You just keep looking at that ship going down. This is what, think about your business this way. Communication failures, according to Society of Human Resource Management, 73% of 1,310 human resource professionals responding to ASHRM, which is the Society for Human Resource Management, said the organization had a clearly articulate strategic direction, but only 44% said it was extremely well, or that they communicated well or extremely well to the employees. Listen to this, 56% said it was not communicated well. So here you have more than half of your companies out there. We have 73%, and then you have half of that 73% that says their companies aren't even communicating well. Do you know what the cost is? I mean, we talked about the cost of just training people to write. We're going to talk about the cost of training people to communicate, the cost of lost product, the cost of lost services, the cost of all of this. So here's a list of communication failures. The key reasons why projects get canceled, okay? I just got done telling you about how projects, you know, that's one of the reasons why communication doesn't work well. Well, in projects, this is one of the reasons why they get failed, why it fails. Number one, business reasons for project failure. Number two, the business strategy superseded. Number three, the business process change, which was business alignment, wasn't correct. Number four, the business requirements management was incorrect. Number five was, this is where we're really getting into it. Number five is business benefits not communicated clearly, or they were overstated. Think about that. I have a project, I have a service, and yet I, as your boss, haven't communicated the importance of it. I haven't told you how important this person or this company really is to us, or I overstated it. That's the number five reason. The next one is clearly technical skills alone are no longer enough. That was from John Venator. He's the president and CEO of CompTIA. He said in a prepared statement, technology workers must have a solid communication skills, both verbal and written, in order to complete projects that are delivered on time, at or under budget, and provide the promised benefits to the organization. Seems pretty good to me. How about this one? This is Ottawa. And what they say is at least two Canadian military bases faced, are you ready for this? Severe communication failures this summer. This was about 3 summers ago. As the National Defense migration created a conflict in the network, which would have taken down the entire national and potentially the internal data networks carrying all DND, which is internal internet protocol, applications, including the search and rescue, intelligence, and the human resource data. How about that? Canada, shut down. Shut down. And then finally, the communication failures is the true impact of ineffective business communications. Another recent survey about the impact of business communication shows that employers are losing productivity due to poorly organized and poorly worded communications. Employees recognize how important written communication is to the effectiveness of their job, but many are not doing much to improve their efforts in this area. So what? Guess what? I want you to know that in this class, and any other class as you move forward, those are probably the two most important words that you have. So what? If you can't answer, if I don't answer that so what, I want you to call in. I want you to call in and I want you to ask me. Because I don't want you to ever leave my classroom asking those questions at all. I want them to be fulfilled because this is a communications class and we have to communicate. All right? Is that a deal? That's a deal on my part. All right. Here we go. Time to jump in and get started. Yes, we've been jumping in, but I even have more for you. I have some great stuff. So let's look at, chapter one. And chapter one has to do with the objectives on this, have to do with communication. They have to talk about the theories of organizational communication. And oh, I need to tell you this. Sometimes I love taking road trips. And so sometimes I might take a road trip over here and then we might come back. So this is why you have to watch this and really pay attention and join in so that you can come along on our road trips, because it's more fun to take road trips, see what's out there, and then come back and see how we can apply it. So if I miss anything, you can be sure that I will get it back the next week. All right, so we're not going to miss nothing. And I'm not one to spend money on books and not use them. We will use our books in this class, so that's what I want you to know, too. We're going to talk about the understanding of the difference between classical and humanistic type of organizational cultures, because this isn't just about an organization, a communication class. This is called, we have to look at the basis of communication so we can apply it to an organization, right? Because you can't apply something if you don't know how to do that, right? I can't go stucco a house if I don't know how to mix the mortar. And that's why we talk so much about communications first. And then we talk about, stuccoing the house. Because then I know how to do it. So we're going to talk about the different parts. I'm going to put them together. And we're going to use them. Then we're going to apply them along the way. All right. So, what are some of the competent in communication skills in employment? Well, here's some of them. Oral presentations. How many of you out there have to do oral presentations? I know I have to do oral presentations all the time. I'm often asked to be a guest speaker. I'm a motivational speaker, and so I'm often asked to come into a lot of different corporations and do that for companies. So I need to understand what oral communication means. What does it mean to stand up here? Just think how boring it would be if I was one of those professors who just kind of sat here and read through the book and told you, all right, the next five things we've got to talk about, ladies and gentlemen, is written communication. We're also going to talk about the listening communication, nonverbal communication, and probably some leadership. I don't know about you, but I'd be like, turn that off or click off the books. I'll just kind of listen to her later on or read the book. And that's not what we want to do in this class. We want to be able to put these things together. So, what's the next thing? We're going to talk about new organizational styles, and then I'm going to give our first video. That's, yes, you're right. I do some videos in here so we can kind of pull it together so you can see what I'm talking about, and then we can bring it together. So the first one is about new organizational styles, and what are some of them? Well, if you're working in a company, you'll probably know that these organizations today are more flat. They're not hierarchical. I don't see a lot of layers out there anymore. What I see is flat. Okay? That means you have to do more work and do more jobs, and you have to interact with a lot more people, right? So we have to figure out how to do that. How to do that? I've got this answer for it. Multitasking. You have to learn how to multitask. Those of you that are a lot younger than myself, which is probably a lot of you out there, the baby boomers don't quite have as much multitasking ability because we weren't brought up that way. We're catching on to you, but those of you younger are much better at multitasking than we are because you grew up with it. You grew up with computers and cell phones and music playing and TV going on. And so because of that, you've been able to multitask. Good for you. That makes you great managers. Okay? But now you have to learn how to pull this all together to communicate. And then to look as a manager, right? Because I know some of you are looking out there to become managers. Well, some of you may be managers already. And if you're managers, good for you. But guess what? You don't want to be like what I talked about over here about how you aren't communicating your message and the product isn't getting put out, right? Because you're not going to be a manager for too long, especially in today's marketplace, tough marketplace. So with that, we're going to look at where communication came from. So this is called Communication Evolution. I think you're going to enjoy this. Let's watch this. Communication in the workplace. I'm wondering if maybe I might have said it wrong. You know, maybe I didn't communicate well. Could that be it? Maybe it was me. That could possibly be. We'll give it just a few seconds. There's some great people in the back, and they're certainly trying to find the different segments along the way. But as they're finding it, I can certainly talk about the next segment because we want to spend as much time as we possibly can together. And if they find it, they'll let from just verbal all the way through internet. So many of you are on Facebook, and you're probably, some of you are out there right now texting back and forth saying what your class this is, and so it's evolved. But while it's evolved, which is really interesting, is that it still goes back to the model of communication. We can't skip this. This is the mortar that I was talking about. This is where this all begins. And so if you take a look at this communication model that we're going to use, and I know it'll be put up on the screen in just a second, this model is very simplistic. It's not an overly complicated model. If we look at this model, we have some place where we encode, look at this, We encode. We talk. It comes to you. You decode it. Then you encode a message. You put it through. And I decode a message. How simple is that? That is just very simple. Hey, Dr. Green, we got it. No problem. As far as we're concerned, we are expert communicators. Not so. Not so.
because while this model is so simplistic, it is complex. It is truly a complex model. And this is where people seem to mess it up.
Now, yes, I encode a message. I'm thinking about how can I present this material in such a way to you that you are getting it, that you understand from my background, from my theory background, that I can mesh it together and bring you in on the process. That's what my job is, okay? That's easy enough. Now, I have to think about that. Then I encode it. As I encode it, it comes out. It comes over to you, and you decode it. Now, think about this. You've got 70 people in this classroom. You have 2.5 million people out in television land. Do you think you're all thinking alike? Absolutely not. Absolutely not. So, you're going to take that piece of information that I sent to you, and you're going to take it apart, and you're going to weigh it against your own ethics, you're going to weigh it against your own values, you're going to weigh it against your own background, you're going to weigh it against what your parents have told you, you're going to weigh it against what the book is telling you, and then you're going to weigh it against maybe what your friends or your spouse or your significant others, whoever, you're going to weigh that information. And you're going to come out with the same information from, you know, information in, information out? Probably not. It's the same idea as when you look at me straight on, right? You're seeing me different than if I turn and you see me sideways. Different. Same thing. I speak, you hear, but you have to decode against you and what you have to put on the table. Yeah. All right. So what, Dr. Green? So what? Okay, there comes that so what again. Well, here's the so what. Now you decode. And now you come over here and your job is to encode. You have to encode it. Well, when you encode your message, it is going to be on the idea his encoding, right? It's going to be based on your culture. It's going to be based on all of the things that I just got done talking about. Now, while that's, again, interesting and such, you're going to encode that and send it over to me. Which, of course, goes through the same process again, which I just got done talking about. I decode it. I decode it against the source of my information. Interestingly enough, right? We got that down, Dr. Green. Got it. All right. So where is it so darn difficult in this process, Dr. Green? I'm going to tell you where it's so darn difficult. The difficulty lies, besides when you're decoding and have to implement it into me, and I have to decode, that's the first place. But there's another piece that's more important than this, and that's here. Look here. Right here. This piece. This piece in here is where problems occur. What kind of problems? Well, because I've encoded it, I'm sending it through this spot over here to your decoding. But it doesn't just go through as a straight line here. Oh, no. It doesn't do that, ladies and gentlemen. It has problems that it's going through. Here are some of the problems that it's going through. It has to go through your values. It has to go through your beliefs. It has to go through your language. It has to go through your perceptions of life. It has to go through maybe some inadequate information because maybe you went out and had got a new glass of water and you're coming back and all you see is squiggly lines. You have no idea what I'm talking about. It has to do with timing. What happens if I talk really, really, really slow or I add all of those expletives? Really, really, really. That would kind of drive me crazy, make me not want to listen. What about lack of feedback? Maybe when you send it back this way, I don't want to give you decent feedback. What happens if you misread my nonverbal? See, like right now, you don't have my nonverbal. All you have is my intonation. So you hear that I'm getting excited about this because I do get excited about all of this. But if I, again, had a monotone, maybe it wouldn't be that exciting for you. What about if I'm giving you too much information so you have information overload? Or what about, oh my, what about communication anxiety? That could be a problem as well. Maybe communication anxiety. Or maybe there's another piece, and this is huge. I'm going to use two hands here. I'm going to say this is trust.
What about trust? Do I trust that person enough to listen to them, to believe what they're saying? Or maybe environment. Maybe it's too hot in your house. Maybe it's too cold in the office. Maybe it has too much lighting. Maybe you need glasses. Maybe you have the message isn't clear because you don't particularly like that person. Or what about external environment? Noises outside like the freeway, or maybe the lawnmower is blowing, or maybe it's you're thinking about what you're going to do at 1 o'clock this afternoon or 2 o'clock this afternoon if you've taken this fabulous class. All of this has come into play, and I've just gotten a memory overflow. This computer is smarter than we all are. Memory overflow. Of course there's memory overflow. What do you think we have every day? It's memory overflow. Information overflow. That's why this particular piece is so complex, ladies and gentlemen. So complex. This is why I spend time on this. Because people don't get it. They don't understand that between my mouth and your ears, there is all this garbage, there's all this noise, there's all everything. And because of that, why do you think we have miscommunications? Why do you think we can't communicate well? That's the questions that I have for you. Now, it's that time. I'll put this ball out here, so I'm looking for you to participate. We're going to continue on, but I want to hear from you, too. What's your thoughts on this? Do you communicate well? Does your company communicate well? Does your boss communicate well? What's the information load that you run into? What do you have out there that are some of the issues? So there's the ball. I'm looking for, any of you to call in. Let's keep this communication going. In the meantime, I'm going to keep going until I hear back from some of you. I don't know if you remember, there used to be a commercial. And the commercial had this pocket. On the pocket was a mouth. And the mouth said, it was talking about the stain, about how it had a stain on its, you have a stain on its shirt. And so, you couldn't communicate with that person.
You had a little lips right here. The lips were stained, right?
And because of that, what happened is we weren't able to communicate. So I didn't even mention about nonverbal. I ain't talking about the written side of the communication on here. But what I'm telling you here, ladies and gentlemen, is that this particular model that you know, this particular model that you look at, is the basis of all good communication. And without all good communication, you don't have communication within a company. You don't go anywhere. I've given you research after research after research after research. You have to be able to show that you are a good communicator. Okay? So, again, I'm telling you that this is a piece that I don't want you to forget. And that's why I go crazy over this. This is why I make it so vivid for you so you can see. I'm going to give you the next video that I want you to look at. This I think relates to what I'm talking about on here. So we're on video. We'll look at our next video, and I think you get the idea of how important communication is. Let's roll that tape, please.
This is the Prometheus of the world. It could start with the media revolution, with the internet, at the end of the last century. Everything related to the old media vanished. Gutenberg, copyright, the radio, television, advertising. Your world reacts. More restrictions for copyright. New rules against authorized copies. Faster, the music didn't accompany is soon. At the same time, free internet radio appears. Tingle, the internet solution, allows the viewer to avoid commercials. Opens the journal, goes online. Google launches Google News. every day is of people read by news. The media is not like newspaper written by thousands of journalists. Flavor has the biggest repository in the history of photos, YouTube for movies. The power of the masses. The new figure emerges, the consumer, the producer, and the consumer of information. Anyone can be a consumer. The news channels become available on the internet. Blogs become more influential than new media. Newspapers are released for free. Wikimedia is the most complete encyclopedia ever. In 27 Life magazine columns, the New York Times sells its television and declares that the future is digital. BBC follows. In the main cities of the world, people are connected for free. At the corners of the streets, audience print pages from blogs and digital magazines. Millions of people are now immune to the internet, many virtual worlds. Person can have multiple online identities. Second Life launches the local avatar. New media fight back. Ethics is added on mainstream. Newspapers, radios, and televisions are financed by the state. Illegal downloading from the web is punished with years of jail. Around 2011, the tipping point was reached. Advertisement investments are done on the net. Electronic paper is a mass problem. Anyone can read anything on plastic paper. In 2015, newspapers and broadcasted television disappear. Digital terrestrial is abandoned. The radio goes on the internet. The media arena is less and less populated. Only the easier and lower slice survives. The net includes and unifies all the content. Google buys Microsoft. Amazon buys Yahoo, thus becoming the world universal content leaders with BBC, CNN, and CCTV. The concept of state information, books, articles, images, changes, and is transformed into knowledge flow. Advertisement is chosen by the content creators, by the owners themselves, and becomes information, comparison, and images. In 2020, Lawrence Lessig, the author of A Free Culture, is the new U.S. Secretary of Justice, and declares copyright illegal. Devices that currently in the five senses are available in the short words, reality will be replicated in civil life. Anyone has a data, agent matter, that finds information, people, places in the short words. In 2022, Google launches Prometheus, the American standard interface. Amazon creates Base, a company that replicates reality. You can view Mars and the Battle of Waterloo, and the Super Bowl of the person is real. In 2027, several lives evolve in the spirit. People become who they want and share the memory, the experiences, the feelings. Reselling becomes normal trading. In 2050, Prometheus lies space and spirit. Virtual life is the biggest market on the planet. Prometheus finances other space missions to find new words for its customers. The terrestrial avatar.
Pretty interesting, huh? I think that's just amazing how we're integrating all of these companies together. But again, it doesn't happen without communications. All right, so we have our first call today, and let's see who might be on the line. Good afternoon, Rebecca from Topanga. How are you?
Hi.
Good. What are you calling for, Rebecca? What can we do for you today?
Hello?
Yes, hi.
Oh, yes. Actually, I was calling to make a comment about your question, is there communication in the workplace?
Yes.
And I would have to say there is, however, at times it can be very substandard. My role at my job, I have to do the advertising as well as the marketing. I have to try to get information from the C-level management, and they might be out of the country. I have to wait maybe 2 weeks to get what I need. So in that respect, it's hard for me to try to put out that information effectively. Sometimes they might launch a new product and they don't get my input or feedback on it. They just go ahead and, you know, put it through without any input from me, and that could be a little tedious at times. Yes, there is communication in the workplace. However, it can be very
Absolutely, and you probably have not only have the problem of sea level, but also because organizations are becoming more flat, you probably also have the issues of colleagues and how to get the information and for them to buy into what you want them to buy into as well.
Right.
Yeah, certainly. Oh, that's great, Rebecca. Thank you for calling. Perfect.
You're welcome.
All right, good. All right, so that was a perfect way to call. I'm looking for more for the rest of you. In just a few minutes, we're going to have my first guest. And but before we have our first guest, I have another video here that I want to show because I love this one. It is, this one is called What We Have Here is Failure to Communicate. And I just think this is probably a very funny, funny communication that happens often in our business world. So I'm going to ask you to roll this, and then we're going to come back. I'm going to talk just a little bit more about this communication model, and then we're going to call it a break, and we'll come back with my first guest, which you're going to just love. All right, here's this video. So I hope you enjoyed that. That certainly is a way to miscommunicate, even at the top level of our country. We do have a email here today, and so I'd like to read it. And it's Teresa. It's from Teresa. And she says, what do you suggest in communicating for an older or middle-aged person to stay focused on speaking with the words or thoughts float by and if you could speak, that would be really good to Dr. Breed. During a conversation. You know, we all have those happen to us, and they just kind of go out there. And, you know, I do things like, I laugh at myself many times. Communicating isn't just formal, it's informal too. And sometimes you need to say, you know what, I just lost that thought. Just give me a few minutes, let me pull it back, or whoops, let me drop that back a little bit. Sometimes we just need to laugh at ourselves. Communicating, yes, the more we try to think about an answer to the question that's being sent to us, the more our brain is going to be filled with all these answers, and we're really not going to hear what that person is saying. We're not listening to them. And that's one of the issues. And we're going to talk about listening in future weeks. But when you forget something, the older you get, the more we seem to forget. And so, what was I talking about? So, you know, it's a normal thing. It's one of those areas, just laugh at yourself and just say it right out. You know what? I forgot that. That's how you communicate that process. Or write it down. Write the processes down so you have it. You don't see me out here with no paper, right? So I'm going to leave you with this last piece. And while we only got through the communication model, that's okay with me. I don't care that we didn't get through the classical theories, because we didn't get into that yet. Because, as I said to you, I have to build this foundation, and this foundation has to be strong. And so, we'll get to it. Don't think we're going to not get to it. And sometimes we're going to get beyond the chapter. But this week is a very important week for me. The communication process, how we give feedback to people, when we go through that whole diagram, right? It's not only that noise that's in there where you encode and then I decode it. I have to give good feedback, right? So part of this has to do with written communication as well. And we talk a little bit more about written communication later on, but I found this wonderful paper one time years ago, and it was very, very funny. And I thought, here's a perfect example of miscommunication. So it's a true story, and this happened in a London hotel, and it's called those little bars of hotel soap. You know those little bars that you get when you go into a hotel? Well, this is a true story. It was written and it was given to me years ago. You probably can find it out on the internet as well. But it's excellent. It's a perfect way to end today with you and me, and showing misrepresentation of communication and how people look at things differently. So this is what happened. It's a little bit of a joke, but it's a true joke. Okay, so it says, dear maid, please do not leave any more of those little bars of soap in my bathroom, since I have brought my own bar bath size dial. Please remove the 6 unopened little bars from the shelf under the medicine chest and another 3 in the soap desk. They are in my way. Thank you. Dear room 635, I am not your regular maid. She will be back tomorrow, Thursday, from her day off. I took the 3 hotel soaps out of the shower dish as you requested. The 6 bars on your shelf I took out. You know, I have a feeling that I'm reading this. I just wanted to make sure that my communication was well with you. Let's go back. Dear room 635, I am not your regular maid. She will be back tomorrow, Thursday, from her day off. I took the 3 hotel soaps out of the shower dish as you requested. The 6 bars on your shelf I took out of the way and put on top of your Kleenex dispenser in case you should change your mind. This leaves only 3 bars I left today with my instructions from management is to leave 3 soaps daily. I hope this is satisfactory. Kathleen, the relief maid. Dear maid, I hope you are my regular maid. Apparently, Kathy did not tell you about my note to her concerning the little bars of soap. When I got back to my room this evening, I found that you had added 3 little camés to the shelf under my medicine cabinet. I'm going to be here in the hotel for the next 2 weeks, and have bought my own bath-sized dial, so I won't need those 6 little camés which are on the shelf. They are in my way when shaving, brushing, teeth, etc. Please remove them. S. Berman. Dear Mr. Berman, my day off was last Wednesday, so the relief maid left 3 hotel soaps, which we were instructed by management. I took the 6 soaps, which were in your way, on the shelf and put them in the soap dish where your dial was. I put the dial in the medicine cabinet for your convenience. I didn't remove the complimentary 3 soaps, which are always placed inside the medicine cabinet for all new check-ins, and which you did not object to when you checked in last Monday. Please let me know if I can be of any further assistance. Your regular maid, Dottie. Dear Mr. Berman, the assistant manager, Mr. Kentsetter, informed me this a.m. that you called him last evening and said you were unhappy with your maid service. I have assigned a new girl to your room. I hope you accept my apologies for any past inconveniences. If you have any future complaints, please contact me so I can give it my personal attention. Call extension 1108 between 8 a.m. and 5 p.m. Thank you, Elaine Carmen, housekeeper. Dear Ms. Carmen. Thank you, Elaine Carmen. Dear Mr. Kentsetter, my bath soap dial is missing. Every bar of my soap was taken from my room, including my own bath-sized dial. I came in last night and had to call the bellhop to bring me 4 cashmere bouquets. S. Berman. Dear Mr. Berman, I have informed our housekeeper, Elaine Carmen, of your soap problem. I cannot understand why there is no soap in your room, since our maids are instructed to leave 3 bars of soap each time they service the room. This situation will be rectified immediately. Please accept my apologies, Martin Kentsetter. Dear Mrs. Carmen, who the heck left 54 little bars of camphane in my room? I came in last night and found 54 little bars of soap. I don't want 54 little bars of soap of camphane. I want my 1 bar of bath dial size, bath size. Do you realize I have 54 bars of soap here? All I want is my bath size dial. Please give me back my bath size dial. S. Berman. Dear Mr. Berman, you've complained of too much soap in your room, so I had them removed. Then you complained to Mr. Kentsetter that all of your soap was missing, so I personally returned them. The 24 camés which have been taken, and the 3 camés which were supposed to receive daily. I don't know anything about the 4 cashmere bouquets. Obviously, your maid, Kathy, did not know I had returned your soaps, so she also bought 24 camés plus the 3 daily camés. I don't know where you got the idea that this hotel issues bath-sized dial. I was able to locate some bath-sized ivory, which I left in your room. Elaine Carmen, housekeeper. Dear Mrs. Carmen, just a short note to bring you up to date on my latest soap inventory. As of today, I possess, on shelf, under the medicine cabinet, 18 camés in 4 stacks of 4 and 1 stack of 2. On the Kleenex dispenser, 11 camés in 2 stacks of 4 and 1 stack of 3. On the bedroom dresser, 1 stack of 3 cashmere bouquet, 1 stack of 4 hotel size ivory, and 8 camés in 2 stacks of 4. Inside the medicine cabinet, 14 camés in 3 stacks of 4 and 1 stack of 2. In a shower dish, soap dish, 6 camés, very moist. On the northeast corner of the tub, 1 cashmere bouquet, slightly used. On the northwest corner of the tub, 6 camés and 2 stacks of 3. Please ask Kathy when she services my room to make sure the stacks are neatly piled and dusted. Also, please advise her that stacks of more than 4 have a tendency to tip. May I suggest that my bedroom windowsill is not used and will make an excellent spot for future soap deliveries. One more item. I have purchased another bar of bath-sized dial, which I am keeping in the hotel vault in order to avoid any further misunderstandings. Mr. Berman. Now, that is a communication misunderstanding. A And with that, I'm going to say ta-ta for a few minutes. Make sure that you come back and visit with my next guest. He's very, very good, a communication expert, and I'm sure you're going to understand him. Get your telephone, get on the computer, make sure that you're able to write and call him because you don't want to miss out on this. See you in this interview.
I'm watching TV, television, and sons from Washington State University living in cities.
That's 3 mile, 243,
3636.
Well, welcome back, and I hope you had a glass of water and you're ready for some a real treat. My next guest here is a good friend, has come down as a gift to me. He's a consultant marketing and organizational development consultant, done great jobs. I've worked with him for many, many years, and I think that you'll be really, really pleased with what you learned from him. His great stories. Again, the ball is out, which means that it's open for you to call in, to write in. This is a communications class. We expect you to do this. This is part of, you know, the whole class, the exercise. So by all means, I'd like you to call in 800-339-1193. And with further ado, I'm going to go ahead and pass this over to my dear friend and colleague, Ira Lovich. And Ira, thank you for coming down. That was so nice of you. I really appreciate you taking a Sunday, coming down and spending time with my class and with the television group here. So tell us a little bit about yourself and what makes you so fabulous that I would have you as my first guest.
Well, thank you. Thank you, Virginia, for inviting me to come down. It's been a great class so far. I've been part of the class as well, off on the side there. Well, as you know, I was in the corporate world for over 20 years as a marketing and consultant doing strategic marketing on a global scale, and got the teaching bug and have been teaching in a variety of institutions of higher learning. And the passion, which we both share, is to go into companies and help those companies communicate better, to work with their employees or their management, and to assist them at bridging the gaps that they have discovered, and also discovering the gaps that they need to bridge.
Yeah.
So that's what we've done that together in a variety of companies, and of course, I really love helping people to get over their communication challenges.
Gotcha. Tell me a little bit about your company that you have out there and what you're doing it.
Well, working with the Biz Visions Group has been a real pleasure, specializing in helping companies to uncover their challenges, and then to go in there and work with their executives, their managers, in many cases their line employees, to develop better communication techniques, to learn some tools, and oftentimes learn a new language that enables them to communicate in ways they were unable to before. And most companies, as you mentioned, can boil their challenges down to communication challenges. Anything else that will prevent companies, as well as individuals, from reaching their full potential.
So great, so great. I know that you've worked in many different companies as well, and we've talked about the idea of communication and how it's the basis for everything. Of course, you know, the last hour, that's what all I've been talking about. What have you seen as some of the problems out in the company specifically to communication?
Well, I guess one of the areas that came so clear to me is the fact that people make assumptions based upon their background. You mentioned earlier with those squiggly lines that you were using to enhance the chart that was up earlier. And I had a former student, an MBA student, that went to work in New York City at one of those big tall bank buildings. And she told me the story later on. She worked there as the assistant to the president, but only assistant, as an administrative assistant. It's sort of a Donald Trump way. She was the protege of this bank president. And a gentleman came in downstairs to the security guard and said he would like to speak to the bank president himself. And the security guard was sharp enough to recognize a $3,000 bounty suit when he saw one, and they sent the guy upstairs to the penthouse. And after shaking the bank president's hands, he reached into his pocket and dumped a set of car keys on the bank president's desk and said, "These are the keys to my Rolls-Royce Silver Cloud. This vehicle is worth $300,000. I would like to leave it with you as collateral and just borrow a couple of thousand dollars from you for, maybe for a week or so." And, my former student, being the smart apprentice that she was, gets her assistant to go downstairs, and in the parking garage is a beautiful pearl-white Rolls-Royce Silver Cloud convertible with a white top and white leather interior. The vehicle was beautiful, and they checked out the title on the glove compartment, and it belonged to this guy. So they came back upstairs, he signed some papers, and they counted him out, $2,200 bills. He had his $2,000, and he was gone. and my former student associate boss, collateral has wheels and could have a second set of car keys. Let's lock it up tight in secret storage down in the outskirts of the parking garage, just in case. And they do that, and a couple weeks later, he comes back, asks the security guard to come back upstairs to the penthouse to pay off his loan. And when he gets upstairs, he asks the bank president if he could bring his car around and tell him what he owes. And my friend gets her assistant to come in and calculate, well, a couple of weeks' interest. So it turned out to be $2,000 plus $57.60. So it starts to write a check out for $2,057.60 and asks for his vehicle to be brought around. And my former student says, you know, I checked you out. Hope you don't mind for asking, but I can't for the life of me figure out why you, as rich as I found out you are, needed to borrow $2,000 from our bank. And he writes out his check and puts it on the desk and asks them to bring his car around and says, of course I didn't need to borrow $2,000 from your bank, but where else could I park my Rolls Royce Silver Cloud? In New York City, it only cost me $57.60 for 2 weeks, and I didn't know that he was going to touch that car. Some of your listeners have probably seen that Ferris Bueller's Day Off,
where
that Ferrari's in the parking garage and misses the keys with the valet.
Yeah.
So oftentimes you
can. I love that story, by the way. I've heard you say it many times. I just love that story.
What I learned from this former student of mine is that oftentimes it's the assumptions that are the barrier to communication. Because all along the way, different assumptions were made. The security guard made an assumption about the fella and his $3,000 suit. They made an assumption about somebody holding a $300,000 car. And all along the way, different individuals took their context, as you displayed on the chart, and they brought their context of the communication and made an assumption. And were they actually understanding the situation, or were they actually falling prey to a preconceived assumption about the situation? That's where a lot of communication, I think most communication, that's where the communication hangs up, right there at the assumption.
Oh, that is a great story. Like I said, I've heard you say this story over and over again. It's probably my very favorite story of yours that you talk about.
Well, you know, it's like this is one that you've probably heard before. Maybe some of your listeners have as well. And it was about the fellow that was driving on PCH, Pacific Coast Highway here, in this very fancy Porsche, another fancy car story. And he's going around the curve, probably driving a little too fast. And a fella in an old pickup truck comes around the curve and yells, "Pig!" out the window. And this guy's thinking, well, why is he calling me a pig? I worked hard for this Porsche. And he's driving a little too fast. And so all these things are spinning in his head. And as he's reaching out to give this guy in the pickup truck an obscene gesture, he goes around the curve and smacks right into the pig. And so he's thinking he was being insulted. He was being warned. And that's what the first story was about, is that he made an assumption. And in this case, the assumption cost him a fender.
Yeah. So in companies, we have this happen to us all the time, don't we?
And that is because we all grow up in different homes. And even studies on twins, I think, have found out in sociology and psychology, twins can grow up in the same home and have totally different ideas, just like siblings can be so different. And so two individuals are going to have two different ideas about any subject, and they're assuming they're communicating. Because they're bringing their assumptions about what that word means, what that situation means. And oftentimes we find out, we've all heard about the $5 billion failure of the Mars Voyager. I worked with a colleague who was a rocket scientist, and she worked on that project. And the way she explained it, half of the most brilliant people we have, the rocket scientists, as we use that as a way of describing brilliant people, right?
Well,
half of them use English measurements. And half use metric measurements. And so $5 billion project, literally, you know, humans or animals were on that. And that $5 billion project never made it to Mars. Just because they made assumptions. One was using one set of measurements, one was using the other. And they never stopped to question, was there an assumption that might short-circuit that project? And that's a $5 billion puzzle. That's a big one. Of course, it was a manned spacecraft. It could have been treasure.
One of the things that I said to our viewers out here was two words. So what? So what, Ira? So what? You know what? People make mistakes all the time. You know, $5 billion to some people is nothing. Why should we communicate well? From your point of view, I mean, you're called in often to investment companies. Tell us why they're calling you.
Well,
what's the so what?
Well, the so what is oftentimes, I would say, maybe most often, from my experience, the problem is not the product. The problem is not the service. The organization does what it does well. And I think that's the most fun for me, and probably is for you as well, is not being called into companies that are failing. Being called into companies that are actually succeeding, but they're not reaching the potential that they could reach. Because the products or the services they market, they have good people. All the ingredients are there, but they don't know how to combine them. They don't have the recipe. And so they might have every ingredient they need, but they throw them in there and somehow it doesn't taste well. And so they need somebody who has work that you've done as well to come in there and help them figure out what's the right mixture, what's the right recipe for their good ingredients. Now, there's many companies, of course, that have don't have the right ingredients, and that's a whole other story. And what I have found, probably you have as well, is that it's a lack of communication, it's a lack of understanding that is preventing that company, that's the so what, to take a step back and realize it's not coming up with a better product. Or even fixing the product they have is figuring out how the individuals in the organization can communicate their ideas in a better way and how the organization can foster that communication. Because you and I have, you know, done a number of trainings in 2009, and I can recall several times being in a room with a closed door, all the executives are out, and the individuals, they complain that they just don't have the freedom to really say what they need to say, to criticize, to call out the organization, to call out those C-level individuals and say, no, they need to be able to pull that chain and say, stop the train, stop the bus, we're going in the wrong direction, but they just don't have the courage because they don't feel that they're going to, that's the so they don't feel they're going to have the opportunity to honestly and frankly and candidly communicate what they see is wrong in their own company. So they want to fix them. They care about their company. They have a good heart, but they've been taught, they've made an assumption that nobody's really listening.
So how do we fix that?
Well, organizations, first of all, need to make a commitment, and sometimes they can't do it on their own. And just like a couple might go to marriage counseling, people that are in a committed relationship. I remember I have two cousins that are a lot of fun. And they're both from opposite political parties, and they've been married over 30 years, and they recently walked precincts in the last election for totally different points of view, and they have a loving relationship. They're a testament to why can't we all get along? And they remind me of this fact, so that, you know, we have to understand that just they went to marriage encounter, and they went to this organization that was there to make their good marriage better. And I think that's what organizations don't realize. If it ain't broke, make it better. We get called in oftentimes, like when people go to marriage counseling, when things are on the rocks. But it's when things are okay, is when we really can do the most good. And that's the so what is organizations sometimes need a facilitator, need an outside set of eyes and ears, somebody that's maybe worked in many different companies, and that's what we do when we come in there with the experience of 50 or 500 different organizations that have actually gone through the same trials and tribulations to teach them how to bridge those communication gaps.
Good, good. Ira, how can effective communication help an organization achieve its goals?
Well, number one, the organization has to understand what their goals are. And very often those goals maybe are not understood well by every level of the organization. So I would say the first step that is to get everybody on the same page as the same today. And oftentimes we find that organizations have different levels and each level has their own agenda. And the first agenda, let's be realistic, is let's keep our job. So pay our bills, take care of our families. And the second agenda might be to accomplish the corporate goals. So recognizing every individual has their own corporate goal, their own corporate strategy, their own vision, and that's survival. And that's holding on to their game. And so that's, we have to peel that layer back so that the individual is not afraid. Because oftentimes the person that's on the lowest level, that's really with hands-on, that has the best ideas. I remember I worked with a corporation, and the purchasing department back in the East Coast had bought brooms for the warehouse, and the brooms were 24 inches in length. The only problem was the length between the racks was 36 inches, and so the person sweeping that warehouse got to go up one side and down the other, so it took two motions instead of one, because the purchasing agent never bothered to ask the custodian who knew best, how was the best person to ask about buying brooms.
You know, that's exactly why we look at communication. We go so much into the model, because if you understand that model, just like that little hotel bar of soaps, right? You know, I mean, the miscommunication that was there, just like here, the miscommunication, so you can understand what the organization is looking at and what it needs, what are the needs of the organization. But it all comes again through communications.
And the individuals that are in this class, as some of them might be managers, many of them I'm sure are employees, have to be encouraged, and that's by their senior management, by their immediate supervisors, to get involved in fixing the organization. So everybody at every level needs to be able to pull that ring and stop the bus, and to be able to stop a line in a manufacturing facility. Encouraging those employees is the first step, and that's why we need to work from the top down, not from the bottom up. And when senior management makes that commitment, it is beautiful. They're the conductor of the orchestra. They select the music, and if they're conducting well, then all the rest of the instruments, the violin section, the trumpets, the horns, the brass, everybody makes beautiful music. And if they're not able to really conduct the orchestra well, if the music isn't in front of the musicians, then we're just going to hear a bunch of dissonance and it'll be noise.
I want to take this time to tell you the ball's out. That means that you are to call in 800-339-1193 or go ahead and send us an email and we'll read it on the line here. I see we already have one, so that's good. Maggie says, is there a difference in strategy facilitating communication in a large corporation other than or in a small company?
Well, that's a great question, Maggie, and thank you for bringing that question up. In most small companies, individuals wear many hats, and so that can be a challenge because the founder or leader of the company is very much present in most small companies, and oftentimes you're right there at the helm. And so it's like a large company where the seat of power is very, very far away in a different city, even in a different country. So the first challenge is an opportunity. The challenge is that person that founded the company is often maybe 4 steps away from them, which means they're used to being hands-on and they might not want to let the reins go. The challenge also is an opportunity, because those of us that want to fix those small companies have the opportunity to have a direct interaction between you and the person who made that decision. But the large company has the ability of insulating us also sometimes from these decisions, and the small company does not. So I would say I've worked for small companies and I've worked with large companies, and I appreciate the differences. People are all people. I believe we all have our hearts in the right place, no matter whether in a small or a big company. But I do agree with Maggie that I think that communicating with managers in a small company can be a challenge, much more so than a big company.
Yeah, but, you know, Ira, what happens when I get a manager and I try to communicate with them and tell them a problem and they just say, deal with it. This is our next email.
Wow. Well, and I guess I should have prefaced this by indicating that I don't believe there's always a quick fix or an easy solution. And there are some people that are working for companies where probably their best choice is to find someplace else to work when they're able to. So there, we do get bosses that are butt nuggets, and we just have to live with the fact that they have their own set of issues and problems. I do have to tell you, though, that I had an experience where I was working for a great woman who was my mentor over many years. And I honestly, when I first saw this woman's job, I thought she didn't do a thing. I thought she went to meetings all day long, and really was kind of a lazy. And then she went off on maternity leave and asked me to take over. Ever since I did her job and my job, and I realized by walking a mile in her moccasins that actually, just a little step ahead of the boss here, that she did have a lot of responsibility, and she did a lot. It's just that I wasn't exposed to it, I didn't perceive it, and so I assumed that she wasn't doing anything. And frankly, she was so good, she made it look easy.
And so you weren't looking from her point of view?
I was.
Your perception?
My perception, my assumption was, and a lot of us, maybe not you, but Lori on the phone, so a lot of us can make an assumption that the boss is always wrong, and that the boss is, sometimes they are. But if we can, perhaps if we're able to perceive things from our boss's point of view, maybe it might be easier for our boss to perceive things from our point of view. We might just have to be the one to take that first step.
And isn't that part of communicating as well, is to get them involved, to ask them to maybe help? If I don't understand it, and I'm asking for, you know, for your help, and you just tell me to deal with it, what's my next step? I mean, yeah, I can quit. Yeah, I can think about their point of view, but can you walk me through the steps that, if you were my mentor today, what would you tell Virginia to do with this boss that just told me to deal with it? How do I do this, Ira?
Well, let's say that the situation, we're already pretty knee-deep in it, and you might just have to deal with it. But we'll come back to that in a minute. Let's set a framework, though, so that we don't want to get knee-deep in it again. So, maybe we can do a reverse timeline. And we're here. We're in this spot here. And let's go back several steps and figure out how do we get to where we are now. And maybe there might have been some clues, there might have been some triggers, there might have been some tripwires along the way that maybe we could have gone to our boss sooner. Maybe we went there too late. Maybe we have to take some responsibility on our shoulders, and perhaps the next time a situation comes up, we need to jump in fast and furiously and bring this to the boss's attention so maybe we can solicit some of their help before they tell us to go deal with it. And sometimes we end up with bosses that we know more than they do. And oftentimes they don't have the skill set. They may have been promoted to a manager, but they may not have the skill set that we do. And they may have only one opportunity, which is to tell us to deal with it because they don't know better than we do. So hopefully that helps by taking the stand so the next time a situation starts to resemble this, we'll get in there early and ask for some help before perhaps we're putting our boss up against the wall and they don't like it.
Right. Good. Excellent. You have another question here. It says, when you go into a company to consult, do you answer or fix a problem they present, or do you review the company's procedures in its entirety and make recommendations on them? So I think they're asking, do you just give blank answers, or are you more to help them work through it?
Ideally, a 360-degree review is what I always want to do in every case, and a full checkup, so to speak. But sometimes you got to do things, you know, you got to go to the dentist and have them drill it out, and you might not have time to go through the whole process.
Right.
So ideally, a 360-degree review is useful because rather than just working on prevention, well, working on a cure, pardon me, I'd rather work on prevention. So being called in to fix something tells me the company probably should have had somebody in there earlier to deal with whatever caused the problem. So I agree with it. The question is, I would prefer to be in there doing a complete review, but oftentimes the company doesn't have the budget or the time. I mean, if you got to go out there and if there's a fire, you got to put out the fire first, but I would hope to come back in later and start looking around for combustible material, lack of smoke detectors, perhaps are the exits all in the right place. So I would say that initially we might have to just put that fire out. But if the company is really committed not to just putting out fires, then a fire prevention program is best. And I can give you an example from when we were recently training in a company, and this question came up, and one of the individuals in the audience brought something up, one of the managers of this company. I think you were out of the room, and this individual said, one of the challenges here is people get patted on the back for how well they put out fires. So it's a way to get notoriety. It's a way to achieve a semblance of respect in an organization. So sometimes the individual almost likes the fire because it's a way of, well, first of all, avoiding the mundane, boring work. And it's also a way of getting kudos in an organization. It's not as exciting to put in a smoke detector. It's not as exciting to do the inspection as it is to get up on a ladder and say somebody on your back. And that is also one of the challenges of oftentimes individuals and organizations. They get rewarded for being a firefighter, and they just don't get rewarded for good fire prevention. So one of the things I'd like to do with an organization when I go in is try to change their culture and try to work on giving adequate rewards for people that prevent the problems from happening. Not just those supers, it's not just for Superman or Superwoman who flies in and saves the day.
Yeah. You know, I had something of the same thing happen with a colleague of mine. She was writing journal papers, and she wanted to go to Spain or someplace to do the paper, to get the paper. And the dean said, sorry, we can't send you to Spain. And she said, but you just sent so-and-so to wherever they got sent to. He goes, yeah, but they're behind on the amount of papers that they have to write. And she said, but I'm forward. And he said, I can't help it. They're behind, and we need to keep them in compliance. Therefore, we're going to send them wherever they want to go. What I hear you saying is that when you go into companies, you look at this misrepresentation of authority, of communication, and you put that communication out there so that people, because sometimes when we look at things, we don't see them like in that model that we talked about earlier in the beginning. We don't see it from all perspectives. And so you, Glenn, is you're almost like the detective with the magnifying glass looking at the entire process and then giving the results and teaching people to change those results. Am I hearing you correctly?
Absolutely. The detective is a great, great analogy. I think of my favorite TV detective. I think he's probably on reruns, Columbo. And Columbo, he'd walk around and investigate, and finally in the end, he'd go home and ask one of those questions. And I love that guy. And if an organization is serious about getting better, then they do need to bring a detective in. And the reason why it can't be done internally is because everybody internally has a horse in the race. And so there's no way they can be impartial. And that's why individuals like yourself and myself have been successful as toy organizations. We bring in outside help. That's why most of us use consultants. We don't, cutting your own hair is probably not a good idea anymore than doing your own brain surgery. And a lot of us would prefer to hire, outsource our lawn to be mowed and our taxes and our professional services. So it's like any other professional service we might outsource. It's the same thing. We're outsourcing an independent third party that doesn't necessarily have a horse in the race and axe to grind. And we're able to come in as a detective and uncover perhaps what is so obvious. And I think that's a funny thing because oftentimes I find it's obvious in a short amount of time. I obviously have figured out what the problem is and I'm staring everybody in the face. But it's like the emperor's new clothes. Nobody wanted to say anything about it. So everybody kept their mouth shut. And oftentimes it's so plain and easy to figure out. I rarely can remember where the detective work really required that much investigation. And you'll find that individuals in the organizations want to tell us what's going on. So they're chomping at the bit, they're anxious. I would say the one thing from the questions we've been getting is that what most bosses have to realize is 95% of their employees really care and want to do a good job.
That's right.
We just need to enable them, give them the tools and give them the confidence that they can speak up because they're your best consultants.
Right.
Nobody can hire us full time to have us sit there. It doesn't make sense. It's like having as their caretaker. Their employees are their caretakers.
Right.
What our job is to come in there and empower them and help them to help their employees to become the caretakers conversation. And then with a little bit of tweaking here and there over time, the active staff members will help guide the company much better than any way you or I could. Once we get the goal.
Ira, this has been great. You're fabulous with communication. I've seen you work, and I know the companies that have had you have been very pleased with your help for them. We thank you very much for coming on our show, and for those of you, we appreciate you for writing in to us and having us help you with some of your issues along the way. Again, one of the things that I'll be asking you to do throughout the week is to write questions for next week, and I'll be asking some of those also to our experts along the way. I know that you could find Ira if you'd like. It's all right if I give out your phone number here. Ira, it's 818-903-5470. And maybe you can even talk to Ira at that point, or, you know, if you have communication questions or whatever, that would probably be a good thing. Is there, we have about a minute left, Ira. Can you give us any words of wisdom before we close off till next week?
Well, I would like to encourage everybody out there to be courageous, to have courage, to not be afraid, to stand up for what they believe in, and you just might find out. Just might find out by taking a stand that everybody else in your organization was just waiting for somebody to show some courage. And maybe you're the one that'll be the tipping point. So go out there and do it.
That's excellent. That's excellent. And again, you know, if you get a moment, go ahead and write to Ira. Your email, do you want to tell us your email account?
Certainly the easiest one would just be IraL@me.com. IraL@me.com. If your companies would like to chat, always happy to chat with you to figure out if there's something we can do to help.
Well, that's awesome. That is really excellent. So, again, next week, what we'll do is we'll go right into Chapter 2, go back, read your book through Chapter 1, through Chapter 2. Please get your questions ahead of time so that you can call in. It makes it really interactive along the way. We really enjoy having those. And so, with that, we're going to say goodbye, have a wonderful Sunday, and I'll see you next week. Bye now. Take care. Thank you.